My name is Ștefan Nicola. I'm a security penetration tester with KPMG Romania for almost 1 year and a half now. I have the bachelor's degree in informatics, and I'm currently studying for the master's degree with ITNC security. Also, my main interests are web application security, mobile application security, but I'm also curious about binary exploitations. I'm hereby joined by my colleague Daniel Tomescu.
Hello. I'm Daniel Tomescu. I work as a security penetration tester with a team of KPMG Romania. I've got my formal education from University of Bucharest. I'm also an offensive security certified professional and critical penetration tester. My interests are in the field of web applications and everything related, but also internal penetration tests and red teaming exercises. I will also introduce our subject here, BORG, not really robot or robot. The main goal was, so we got this robot, yeah. We had to assemble it and make it work for various presentations and proof of concept demonstrations for our management. So playing with it, we got really attached by to BORG, and we really named it Robi the robot. Until one day when one of our partners came and you know, with a French accent saying Robi the robot is not very easy, so we named it BORG. Besides making it work, we are really curious to see how it works and how it should not work. What are its features from a security point of view? Having a presentation about BORG is safe for our management? Can it be hacked during the presentation? This was one of our concerns.
What does this robot have more exactly of the referring to the configuration? Well, it has 72 rotors for controlling the legs, the hands, and also the head. It also has an embedded camera on top of its head, which is nice, and it has its own Wi-Fi port. So regarding this one, we can actually see that it comes open by default, but it can be also configured to join an existing network or to set a password to it. So what were the expectations when we came across this research project? Well, first of all, we expected some kind of Bluetooth connection, but we got a Wi-Fi one. And actually, we encountered the first defense mechanism, which is allowing a single CNC connection. So only one guy would actually control the robot. But however, it allows multiple devices to connect to its access point. So this kind of went into a fight on who's going to go first. Okay, so I touched a little bit about the access point. I will be talking about the web interface findings, more exactly the API's web interface. Also, I will speak a little bit about the network layer attacks and some fun stuff at the end. So first off, we scanned the robot and we found the following ports. So the first one, the port 23, which is for incoming command and control communication. In order to use the robot, one must download the mobile application or the desktop application in order to successfully communicate via Discord. But there can be bypasses, so we'll see later. Also, port 34, which is used for live camera streaming. It's a video streaming, which is actually encoded. Port 80 is for the web interface of the access point. And port 8080, which is for command line interface. So first off, the web interface findings. We kind of pen tested a little bit on the web application. So first off, what were the expectations when going into that web application? Well, we expected some kind of strong login mechanism, some authorization or authentication or anything, but in reality, we did not find any of this. Now, about the title of the presentation, which is Minute Hacks. What do we mean by that? Well, we actually are referring to hacks that are found, let's say, in a couple of minutes or on the fly, or more exactly, low-hanging fruits. So here are some examples of them. First one, persistent cross-site scripting, which we can see that it's in system name. Also, the SSID is vulnerable, but there's a catch here, because if we inject in the SSID, actually the victim might notice the payload inserted in the value when they're trying to connect to the access point. The next one, the mobile application is integrated in the web view, so it actually is affecting also the mobile application. The next one, we have an operator vulnerability, which we can redirect the victim wherever we want to, injecting in the 0-1 parameter actually. And heads up for the next one, so for all the users that are using Internet Explorer with compatibility mode on, we have identified the process scripting vulnerability, but actually the response we received is content type is explained, so yeah, not much you can do with that. But even though these last two vulnerabilities are trivial ones, let's say, it does reflect the attention that the producer actually involved in this web application. So, next one is the port 8080, which we found out that is actually a command line interface. It's more like a BizBox. Again, when trying to connect to it, we can see no authentication mechanism or authorization one. What can we do with this? Well, this is the list of the actions that we can use in the command line interface. From all of these, we can note help, exit, and we can also note servo, which allows us to move a servo. When assembling the 72 routers, we have also names for them, we have IDs. So by using this command, followed by the name of the servo and the power, or the angle to move, we can actually rotate a certain leg or a certain body part. So by doing this, we actually can bypass the logic of the, let's say, the functionality of the robot, because, as I said earlier, one needs to download the mobile application or the desktop application in order to successfully interact with the robot. So we can just use the servo and we will successfully move it. So speaking about the mobile application, after we download it, we kind of need to insert a valid account. So we need to register first. And by doing so in the web application, we can actually see by analyzing the shared preferences, the preferences.xml file, we can see the password, which is in clear text, the email, and also the terms of use that were agreed to. But this vulnerability actually is present also in OWASP mobile, so yeah, even though the rights are just on the owner and the group. So we left with port 24, which is actually the live camera streaming. Even though that it was encoded, you can find on the producer's webpage, you can find the SDK. So by using that free SDK, we can actually come up with some pretty nice video live camera streaming from inside the room without even authenticating it or anything else. Okay, now speak a little bit about fun fact about the robot. So, as I said at the beginning of the presentation, the robot can actually be set to join existing wireless connection. After giving some configuration to it, the robot must restart in order to successfully apply the configurations. What's the problem here? Well, first off, we may provide not so correct SSID. So, or a bad password. In this case, the robot will try to connect to non-existing SSID and will actually fail. So, the robot will be stuck in this particular denial of service situation. The only thing to actually get it moving again is to physically reset the robot using a mini button. So what can an attacker do with this? Well, an attacker can make a script or something in order to successfully provide a password to the robot, and so the owner now is not able to access the robot anymore. What can you do with this? Well, nothing too much, because you still don't have access. So in order to automate this, we need some kind of script to try to connect to the open Wi-Fi and successfully change the password over and over again when the user is actually resetting the robot. Also, I said earlier about a process scripting, a persistent process scripting, but after resetting it, what can we actually do to make the owner access the web page? Because as you can see, the persistent process scripting is reflected in the home page. Well, one of the things that we can do with this, we can try to deny, again, as I said in this one, we can deny the access of the victim to the robot by setting a password, for example, and also running this small script. What it does, it basically tries to connect every time, over and over again, to the default settings of the robot, and tries to inject the XSS payload inside the homepage. So the scenario would be something like this. The owner will not get access anymore to the robot because we just set the password to it. Will actually reset it by default settings, which is open AB, and then by running this script over and over again, when the robot is resetted, we will actually insert it the XSS payload and we will close the connection to the blog. Okay, Daniel?
Yeah, so just to wrap things up, we got this robot. By default, it comes with an open access point, you can connect to it. Being in the robot's network, you can access without any authentication the web interface, where you can control the robot over CDI. The web interface is also vulnerable to multiple worst of them vulnerabilities, process scripting, open redirect, no authentication, and so on. And even if you try to secure the robot, you put a password to the access point, or you implement by yourself some authentication mechanism, and so on. Resetting the robot over and over again will make it, by default, vulnerable again. So, if an attacker tries to hack this robot, it has a really easy job. There are some attack scenarios which are easily seen. For example, if you see a robot having an open access point, you connect to it, you start controlling it and moving it around using the command line interface, or you can spy on the web camera. If the robot has a password on it, you can try to use a track attack or to just sniff get the PDA password using normal attacks. However, this was just a robot meant for demonstration purposes. In reality, robots are built to have more significant tasks in our life. You know, for example, you can have home robots that clean by themselves after you. This would be nice to be implemented faster. You can have robots that take care of the children, or why not even take care of the adults. So building robots with features similar to humans is really a trend now. You have robots which have to communicate somehow with the exterior. They will probably have something like a Wi-Fi network or Bluetooth connection or something that allows the robot to recognize the owner by biometrics. Any of these solutions are in some degree hackable. For instance, Bluetooth, no Google. Wi-Fi recently had this crack attack, so not as safe as it used to be. And new vulnerabilities you'll also hear over time. Biometrics, this is a never-ending discussion. You can imitate at some degree another person. It really comes to how well the recognition is implemented in the robot. Also, the robot will probably have some sensors to see the exterior. I'm referring here to a camera or a microphone. Okay, so if one robot stops and it doesn't do its job, it's pretty bad. What my colleague explained here, the denial of service for the robot, is pretty bad. For example, if the robot taking care of the children suddenly stops what it's doing, you have a problem. More than that, if the robot is controlled by a third party or something like that, you get to even eviler actions. For example, I will let the pictures speak for themselves. And having a robot in your house that is controlled by an outsider, yeah, this is no good. It can lead to thieves being let in your house to possibly murder. Those are some kind of fantasies and epic scenarios, because it may or may not happen. But in our case, Robi the robot had this camera, which could be monitored by anybody who could access the access point. So it was a pretty serious privacy breach. I would not want to have in my house a robot that sends images to the exterior in any way.